Hey, everybody. If you want, you could take your seats. Grab your seats if you want. We're going to get going here with our official event. And I just want to thank everybody for joining us for the second edition of our Education and Networking Series event here at Photocare Rentals. So let's give it up for Photocare for hosting this event. By the way, if you missed the first event, it's on YouTube. It's all about documentary cinematography. It's awesome, and you can check that out soon. So tonight, we are lucky to have with us three amazing ASC cinematographers, where the focus will be on cinematic lighting. Before I introduce our moderator, let's thank tonight's sponsor, Nanlux and Nanlight, for their generous support. Tom and Paul are over there. Go say hi. And also, let's thank our friends at ShotDeck for helping support tonight's event as well. And they get the award for best swag of the year. So go grab that.
Wait for the raffle.
Wait for the raffle, yep. And let's give a shout out and a thank you to the head of Photocare Rentals, Fred Blake. After the event, say hi to Fred. And also John Kosha, Photocare's general manager right over there on the right. Say hi after the panel. So without further ado, let me introduce our moderator. He's not only DP, but with a long list of film and TV credits, but he's also a longtime professor of cinematography at the School of Visual Arts right here in, of course, New York City. Let's welcome Dejan to come up here. Give it a round of applause. Dejan also runs the East Coast ASC, American Society of Cinematographers. So I'm going to hand over the mic, and let's welcome our friend Dejan Djordjevic, ASC.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael, for inviting us here with my colleagues, Vanya and Maurizio. I'd like to bring up Vanya Trunul. Come on up, Vanya Trunul. Okay. And Maurizio Rubinstein, ASC. This is a very familiar neighborhood. You know, we'll have a seat, guys. And we'll get comfortable. I used to have a production company, actually, right here on 20th and 5th Avenue called Working Pictures during the heyday of commercials. It's kind of the cusp of the Mad Men of commercials, Mad Men era of commercials. So it's nice to be back in the old neighborhood. It's all good. Anyway, let me introduce to my left is Vanya Trunul, and he recently just returned from Great Britain, Wales, I believe, where he's working on Year of the Dragon. And Vanya and I have known each other for quite a while. I've known both of these guys. They're really very dear, very dear, close friends, colleagues as well. Crazy Rich Asians, Gilded Age, The Deuce, Marco Polo. These are just some of the films that Vanya has done and been credited. Maurizio. He worked on the last season, I believe, of Ray Donovan, and the powerful work that was, you know, that when the series moved over here to New York, and he worked on that, and also on City on the Hill, I believe, and Power, and Elementary, and I think we kind of met each other in between the Elementary and Gossip Girl that we both worked on. He also, both are award-winning, and I remember when I first met Maurizio on a film called Bernard and Doris, and it was nominated for Best Cinematography for miniseries, etc. I'm not going to go through all the credits and the awards, but I just want to just say that this is, we're going to riff like jazz musicians here tonight about lighting, because I just saw what the title is here. It's about cinematic lighting, and so we're going to just focus on that. And so, you know, what's our role as a cinematographer? And I think what's common, it was just mentioned that I'm a professor also at the School of Visual Arts. I teach a master class there in cinematography. But every Tuesday I have breakfast with an artist who teaches fine arts, and for quite a few years back and forth. And what we have in common, we speak the same language, and it's just that we use different brushes. I'm working with lighting and camera. He's working lighting with paintbrushes, and we just a different palette. But what our challenge is that we're both trying to express the real 3D world on a 2D in a 2D medium. So yes, light and shadow, color, contrast, the quality of light, quantity of light, the direction of light. I mean, these are all our concerns. These are things that are in our toolkit, you know, as cinematographers. Again, you know, it's we're given scripts, and then our job is to again to promote the and to affect the director's vision of a project, you know, and to come up with a tangible and workable visual grammar, you know, when we translate from the written word to the visual. We of course use visual references from paintings and photographs and other films, which help define the look of a film. I see we got shot deck over here. They're very helpful. I notice you know, a lot of my students and even my colleagues, you know, we wonderful reference. Thank you. Very helpful. What are the things, you know, with lighting? And we're going to have, you know, we'll show some brief clips as well to illustrate some things that are our concern, you know, with lighting. And you know, I think what the first thing I would like to say is that we light direction, you know, the direction of light. You know, what, you know, I'd like to ask, you know, my colleagues here, you know, what is it, you know, when you walk onto a set and you're faced with a scene, what are the first thoughts that come into your mind and with regard to the direction of light?
Well, I try to look at there's really two layers. The first layer is structural lighting. So where you have to work with the space. So I try to first see what makes sense, and for the first structural lighting, as I call it, is a backbone of the whole lighting situation for a particular scene. I'm more interested sometimes where the light is than what it's doing. What makes more sense? And you know, with what time of the day is it? Is it? It's also part of the story. Where is the window? And how does the space work? Ideally, I like to light the space, and then if I have to, I can augment it for the faces, for the actors sometimes. But in ideal world, you just light the space, and ideally before the blocking is even done. So actors sometimes, if they're good, they're going to react to the light. They'll see, you know, if they're doing certain things, they'll be closer to the window because there's more light there. And then you watch them interact with the lighting, and then you augment if you have to. That's the ideal situation. So I like to respect the logic of light, and I like to see what's the. That's why even in the studio situation, I always ask for hard ceiling. I try to make it difficult for me to cut corners and do like take advantage really of the studio. It's like I like to work everywhere as if I'm working on a location. Short way.
Maurizio, the direction of light.
Direction of light. Well, again, you know, we have the same basic beginning in terms of if there's a source, and the source can be a window, it can be practical in case that we're working at night. What is that source, and what kind of emotion we're trying to convey, or feeling we're trying to convey out of that one source? And I try and normally match where that source is and where that source belongs, mm-hmm. to the blocking, so that when I come around and I do the coverage, I can maintain that direction of light and keep it truthful to what I started with.
So what I said a little earlier is that when I look at, you know, the for me it's the direction of the light, the quality and quantity of light, and contrast and color. These are the tools that we have, you know, to work with, you know. And a lot of it also, and I just want to bring up the basis of photography is contrast. And by either having high contrast or low contrast, we're changing the idea, mood, and emotion immediately. And so it also is to reveal and what not to reveal, you know, how much we want to allow and guide the viewer's attention to the scene. And it's also what we also eliminate or just leave in the shadows, you know. So I found it through my experience the degree of contrast is proportionate to the degree of conflict. Interesting, because I found that if you look, if you really think about it, more often than not, you know, the contrast will increase, you know, during a confrontation scene or where there's a beat in the scene where perhaps, you know, where there's an imminent conflict or that's about to happen. So contrast is as well as is very important to me, working with the light and shadow, as to again to evoke an idea, mood, and emotion, you know. And that's the first thing is that when I'm approaching a scene, I'm saying, well, what's the scene about? What are the beats in the scene? You know, where's the change in the scene? Where's has got if it's drama, it's got there's got to be conflict here. And so how are what's the visual grammar here that, you know, you're going to apply, you know, again. And so you know, we can show some examples, you know, to one thing I can show. Recently, I did it was a film. Actually, I came on. It was Frank Prinze. It was the director of photography of this film called The Virtuoso with Anthony Hopkins. But Frank was busy on a film, on a TV series, and so I had the privilege. He said, "Dan, Anthony doesn't want to come to the Poconos in the winter, and it's about 25%, if not more, of the film." He wants to do it in California, in Santa Ynez. I said, okay. And he says, you're doing it. I said, fantastic. Okay, so I had that opportunity to work with Anthony and then to work with the director. And we're talking about getting references here. First thing, I didn't know this director. The only thing he said to me, you know, I'd like to see, you know, The Natural with Robert Redford. And it was a scene where Robert Redford's character is going to the boss of the Chicago Cubs in the office, and he asks himself, why is it so damn dark in here? And well, apparently it mirrors back to, or reflects back to an incident that happened into this owner's childhood, and he feels more comfortable in the dark, okay? But anyway, that was the reference that this director asked me to consider. The Virtuoso is about an assassin. An assassin's agent, and Anthony Hopkins plays the agent that assigns his assassins to different assignments. And so I had to, you know, so it was interesting that we. I said, "Where are we shooting? Where's his office?" You know, "Oh, it's going to be in the producer's ranch in Santa Ynez." Really? Okay. So. So I like to show, just to get a reference, you know, to show what we did, you know, to transform what was, when I first walked in there, was all white walls. And looking out to this most bucolic valley, I said, he wants to make it be like The Natural, huh? Okay. But this isn't a person, Anthony Hopkins' character he's evil. So how am I going to express that? I don't know what Anthony was going to choose for his costuming either, but I'll let you take a look at it, and we'll see. Now, I just want to reference that last shot there with Anthony going, his character going to the window. I said, oh, my God. And this happens to me often when we're talking about references. I started thinking about In Cold Blood, you know, the scene, you know, when and he's reflecting at the window. It's happened to me before. You know, I had a feature in Maine, and it was the mob chasing after someone in the tunnels. And just consciously or unconsciously, it reminded me of the Third Man. I don't know if any would recall that, you know, that what happens in the tunnels, you know, the chase scenes there, you know. So it's a private laugh to myself, you know, because, you know, we are, what differentiates the three of us here is, you know, that we have our skills, you know, we have many years of experience, and it's basically our taste. You know, and what is our taste? Our taste is our cultural background, where we come from, what things, literature and films and everything that has influenced us, you know, in our lives, and that's what we bring, consciously or subconsciously, you know, to a project. Anyway, so I just wanted to just show these very simple, seemingly simple little scenes to underscore, you know, the power of contrast, and didn't surprise me, you know, that he's wearing dark glasses. I didn't know how he was going to show up on set, and you know, I always think about, you know, it's the eyes are very important. And when I was in film school at NYU, I had Nicholas Ray as a professor, and he always said something. You know, Rebel Without a Cause. He was a director of Rebel Without a Cause. He said, the melody's in the eyes. You know, well, in this case, there's no melody in this guy. I mean, this, you know, he's a killer. Didn't surprise me with you know, working with the dark glasses. And where's the source of light? Getting back to the direction of light, it's coming from the back. You know, it's the dominant source of light. I look for what's the dominant source of light. I agree with you. I'd like to light the space and put the character in there, you know. And I find and I see his lighting as 360 degrees. I see we're from the camera, it's at 0 degrees, and then we start moving away from between the relationship between the camera and the person. That's at 0 degrees, and as we move the light over to my left or to my right to 45 degrees or 90 degrees, well, it's not surprising when I look at reels, people ooh and ah when they see the direction of light coming from 90 to 180 degrees, the key light, that is, you know. It's dramatic. It's more contrast, you know. I'll take it from there. You know, enough of my, and if you want to add to something, you know, as far as, you know, working with contrast.
Well, as you were talking, I was thinking about how it is important for me now, and it wasn't always like that, is to light the whole space. You just mentioned that, light the whole set,
right.
Not just light the shot. Because by lighting the whole space, you will discover things that normally you wouldn't. I remember I was starting, when I was on my first films, I was trying to make every shot look the best, so I was literally lighting for the frame. And then, of course, as the productions were getting, as I had a little more resources and real sets, and started to work with multiple cameras, I had to start lighting the whole space. And it is better because you get inspired what naturally happens when you light the whole space. Talking about the contrast, I think it's important if director and myself, if we decide that we want certain contrast, it's also important that it makes sense.
Right.
Because sometimes I see just forced contrast into things, either by the way the things are lit, or sometimes in the post they just add additional contrast. If I feel that the contrast is artificial and then it doesn't make sense with the space and the sources, it just looks like a gimmick to me. So.
Right.
And that's the problem with how we work. You can only really build a believable lighting situation if you have a chance to work with a production designer, so you can talk about which light sources should be where and how the windows should be, and even when you're choosing locations, like, we want to do certain things with lighting, we can't do it in this location, it'll look forced. So ideally, as a cinematographer, we would be there early enough so that we can have all these conversations. Mm-hmm. and that we can actually build the situation in which this contrast would make sense, and pick the right light sources. And I think it's important that we are part mm-hmm. of that, because with light source you can see. It's not only the quality of light that it does. Sometimes it's light source talks about a socioeconomic position of the character. It tells so much, not only what time of the day it is, mm-hmm. How people, what kind of light sources people use, especially if you are in.
Well, certainly with Gilded Age, which you might have a clip.
Well, that was one. I think if you show that clip, that was one where I was really conflicted, because I was the over the first season, what happened at that time in history of New York is transition to electrical lighting. So I was, I had to show the difference between what the oil and gas light looked like. But at the same time, I couldn't overpower the scene with the color of particular light source, because, for example, candles and oil lamps and they're very warm and very just overwhelming the color. That would work against all the work that the costume designer has done. That they've done such amazing. The costumes were just completely out of this world. Mm-hmm. So I thought, I can't just overpower all the colors in these costumes just because I think light should feel a certain way. Right. So I had to find some kind of a compromise.
For that film, you had large windows, broad sources coming in, right?
Right, but I mean, when there was a night scene, when you talk about electricity, right. It was always, it had to be either a night scene or it had to
be a dark
interior. Exactly, yeah. So that was one where my normal process didn't work, because if I really respected what the particular light source would do, I would basically erase millions of dollars of costumes. So it's like
you couldn't see them.
All right, nice. Very fitting, the DC current, Thomas Edison, and big rival was Nikola Tesla, AC. But as far as emulating the light of the time, you started talking about that, as far as, what were some of the challenges you felt to depict, particularly in the interiors like that,
Well, it was mostly that. I didn't want to, I don't like in period films where you have candles everywhere all the time, mm-hmm. just so mm-hmm. we try to make it a rule that the practical lighting would be used as it would if they would use it at the time, which is candles were expensive and oil lamps.
This was the first generation of electricity, correct? Or right before that?
Yeah, so this is actually a historic event.
This was whale oil before that.
Yes, right. Yes. So even people, this is about really wealthy people, but even they would have, all the instruments, lighting instruments, would be taken to the basement where they would be cleaned during the day. If you see film that takes place in medieval Europe, where candles were super expensive, not even kings would be wasting candles in the middle of the day. So it's always, when I see a period pieces that look like a Christmas commercial with all the candles everywhere during the day, we're trying to avoid that and have some logic to how the light sources are used. So that was one, and of course, in these spaces, like in these drawing rooms during the day, the curtains would be shut. So it's like, how are you lighting? So I ended up lighting a lot of the times through a little slit between, through the.
So it was motivated by a little slit in the curtain there, so you'd have a shaft of light coming through there.
Things like that. So I was trying to be as truthful to how the light would actually be used.
Was it predominantly a combination of soft and hard?
I tried to sometimes use hard light on this particular series as much as possible, because talking about costumes again, those costumes where you hit them with a hard light, they really come to life. And there's all this glittering silk stuff that, you know, if it's like underexposed and it's actually first time I was lighting for costumes. I was never like even considering costumes before. And we had this amazing costume designer, Kasia, who was always in my tent. It was like, the costume looks dead, the costume looks dead. I'm like, go away. So after a couple of weeks, I started listening to her. And she actually, and I tried to do justice to her work because she wouldn't go away. And then I learned actually that not only the costumes look better, everything looked better, and it was just another part of my thinking now. That's part of like I actually pay attention now, which I haven't before. So that's what this series has. Kasia has taught me.
And I would imagine you had a lot of tests with the costumes and makeup.
That was particularly to find the color of light, because you know normally, as I said before, normally for something that's gaslight, I would use very warm, like super warm color temperatures, which I couldn't do there. So I was like trying to find the compromise and then also show it to everybody so everybody's on board. So it's like, that's what I was testing a lot. But at that time I wasn't so, I haven't lit, I had one costume maybe at the camera test. But I learned later that, you know, it's really, when you hit the costume with a hard light, it comes to life. So I was always trying to motivate some kind of a light, hard light mm-hmm. source somewhere and keep it off the face also. Right. But you know, I didn't, so it was, those are some of the challenges of this particular show.
I see you had a mandate there from the producer, say you better feature these costumes.
No, it was a costume designer. They were like, I'm sure she was all over them in a certain way, but she's amazing. She thought, she made me a better cinematographer. Yeah.
Maurizio, tell me a little bit about Ray Donovan. You know, going to get back to contrast and noir here. You know, what was your emotional initial response? You know, when you started reading the first scripts.
Well, the show had done 6 seasons in LA, and then they brought it to New York, so that gave the freedom of finding a new look to it mm-hmm. that didn't depart completely from the old look, but being able to rethink certain things. It's a definitely a dark show. And again, you know, the darkness, and it's probably more the darkness than the contrast, defines the subject matter right. Of the story, right? It's a family of criminals, a family where there's some lack of loyalty between the members of the family. So, again, it was stage, and it was locations, mm-hmm. and it was difference between the wealth in which Ray Donovan lived and the not so wealthy situation that some of the other characters in the show lived. So I was co-DPing the show with a colleague of ours, mm-hmm. and we basically sat down and had a conversation about what were going to be the basic ways to approach it. And we started working from there, and we had inherited the crew that had done the previous seasons. So we basically had to also bring them into the new the different way in which we were approaching certain things and
here in New York.
Taking them, take them away from what they were used to do already. All the driving was done on a green screen in the stage. So that was another interesting experience in terms of lighting and the creation of fake light to match with the real light of the plates that were shot to it. And sometimes the plates didn't exist beforehand. They were added later. And the plates weren't shot in the same circumstances as you were lighting. So sometimes there, you know, I see the mismatches. I learned never to use green screen with a convertible if you are actually not shooting the plates yourself, because then, you know, when you see a little piece of the landscape through a window, it's very different than when you see everything, right?
It's all open, yeah.
So then you start having problems of scale and depth of field and height and so on and so forth. But yeah, that was mainly the mood. It was contrasty. It was not intended to be. Once in a while, there were one of the characters is sick, so there's some compassion for him. So that tends to be a little bit softer. The romantic moments also tended to be a little bit softer. But in general,
I was wondering whether you have a scene that that stood out for me that's telling a story with light, and it's, I think it's when he's in the motel.
Yes.
Do you have that here?
Well, there's a little moment of that in the clip.
Because I really thought that that was really telling a story with light.
Yes.
And if you have an example of that, can we take a look?
Yeah, when you see the clip, what Diane is mentioning is there's a scene where half brother of Ray Donovan, who's African American, goes to a motel with a briefcase in which there are some shares from the company of his father, and there's this enemies of the family that dispossessed the father from some of his fortune that he wants to take revenge on, and he's waiting for someone from that family to show up to murder them. And actually what happens is that it's his half-brother who finds out that he's there and comes to the rescue. So
let's take a look.
Thank you. Well, I can see that the black humor of the show really translated in the little clip. What I would like to say again is, it's one of those moments where, like in the case of Vanya, and when I cannot see much here, but when I watched yesterday the clips you sent, then I saw that. It's on the one side is the challenge for the task you have to do, but also the other side is also your intuition and your taste about choosing the type of colors that you're giving to your light for the purpose of what you're searching, especially at night, you know, or in the darkness. Because I think we all have different interpretations of how does the night look, right? Some people think that it's white, some people neutral, some people think cold, some people warm white, because the moon appears kind of yellowish sometimes. And, you know, yeah, I think we choose that in terms of what we're really trying to express, but there's no one answer or definition about what color the night is.
I think you bring up a very good point. I mean, I always felt that the measure is the salt of a cinematographer is just how you do interpret the night and how you play night. In the instance of Donovan, was there a color palette that you were subscribing to that you'd come to some dominant colors? But let's talk about night. I mean, how did you treat night?
Well, you know, again, it depends very much of where you are shooting. If you're shooting in the city, it has a color by itself. It's feasible that you control the lampposts that are the closest to the set, and eventually you replace them with your own light and you change the color, right? But at the distance, you're never going to be able to do that. So at the distance, you're going to show that you did something, you know? Mostly we were working in basis of the existing colors, and also it's the problem starts with the translation. And when I talk about the translation, I talk about shooting in New York City for Boston. That's where the first problem starts, right? Because this is supposed to be something that happens in Boston. So locations and exteriors were all meant to be something that would somehow reflect Boston. Mm-hmm. So those were also then our guiding colors, the city of Boston, mm-hmm. as to try and replicate them here. Mm-hmm. We ended up doing mostly warm colors. I don't remember doing anything that wasn't warm, except in situations like, an exterior by the lake in the middle of the night, mm-hmm. where we were able to be more dramatic as they're fishing out a chopped head in a briefcase that had been sunk into the water, things like that.
All right, I'm going to go on to Year of the Dragon now. So tell us some of the challenges there, because now we're talking a lot dealing with the imagination about what happened maybe years, centuries ago. It's a period, clearly a period film, you know. What were some of the challenges there, clearly, you know, between live action and compositing, you know, things in effects world as well. I can only imagine.
Well, the biggest challenge, or just a different way of working that I never encountered before, there were a lot of visual effects in the show, and they were committed to really do it improve it and make it really amazing this year. So it was House of the Dragon.
A lot of previs.
So that was the process, because I had to commit in pre-production not only to the how the shots are going to be framed, but also how the shots are going to be lit. And they brought me early enough so I could be part of the storyboarding process with the director. So we had to first come up with the storyboards, because they had to start making the dragons. I don't know if I can talk about this, but they had to start making preparing for the visual effects,
right.
Before we even shot anything. So it was that we really had to commit to how the scenes are going to be mm-hmm. shot and mm-hmm. how they'll be lit and
right.
what they'll be
right.
Looking like. So it was a very extensive storyboarding process, and then based on storyboards, they would do a previs. Mm-hmm. Everybody would have to. Sign off of the storyboards and
right.
then on the previews, and then when the day on the day mm-hmm. there was very little, you know, we had basically shoot what we promised to shoot. So
was it a medieval time, or was that the era?
It's a fantasy,
yeah.
it's a
fantasy,
but
medieval.
It's supposed to be medieval Europe.
Yeah, exactly.
But that's again.
Do we have time to show a clip, or should we go to Q&A?
No, that's actually the second clip I had was from The Deuce.
Oh, let's look at. Let's go back to The Deuce, actually. How are we doing on time? Because we can go on, we can riff here for a while.
We should probably go to
yep.
Q&A, so maybe a
okay.
quick clip and then jump into the Q&A.
Okay. Well, then let me hold off on Year of the Dragon, because I thought your work on The Deuce was beautiful.
I haven't really read the NDA, so I don't know what that can say. I just signed it. So I'll have to be careful.
Okay. what would you like us to see for at this point? The next piece.
Oh, so I just brought a piece. Yes, I think that's it from The Deuce.
This is from The Deuce, right?
Yes,
this
which is takes place in 1970s
New York.
1972 in New York.
I think much in the same way you were mentioning about how production design inspires us. And informs us, you know, as far as giving us a guide to where we're going to go with the lighting here. And here we got the 70s; it's gritty, it's desaturated.
Because there were some ideas originally. This was I only did season one, and when I first was hired, there were some ideas about trying to make the show look like those great films. From the 70s that were shot in New York, like The Taxi Driver,
right,
Mean
right.
Streets, Dog Days Afternoon, all those amazing films. And I proposed that instead of trying to put a 70s filter on the camera, maybe we should try to photograph New York as it would look if we showed up in 1972 with the modern cameras. And what would we capture then? Because then,
right.
you know, the,
right.
the emotions were not very sensitive then, and they had to use much bigger light sources than
right.
they maybe right. would have liked. So that was my pitch, and they liked the idea,
mm-hmm.
and I thought the key to do that was to really use authentic light sources, so that every light source has to be something that would be there. So
mm-hmm. Did you work a lot with tungsten and HMIs then?
Well, very little.
Yeah.
I really tried to
yeah.
use it, like light it as much as
mm-hmm.
As much with the practicals as possible.
Okay.
So and also we used even the neon signs were actually 40 years old neon signs, which
oh,
was a
great,
which was horrible. But it was like I think it prepared up because you couldn't really control them. But yeah, that was the.
I'm getting a motion approach. From our sponsors here. We're gonna open it up to the floor here for Q&A. Okay, anyone? Any questions? Please. Go ahead.
Vanya, you in the very beginning spoke about like the authenticity of contrast, which I thought was interesting because like I feel like I've worked on sets where people are, you know, I'm concerned about where the lighting is based on where it would be naturally, and I get feedback that it's like, oh no, like audiences are very forgiving. Like they're not paying attention to how real the lighting is to an extent, right? Like, because like you said, like there are certain situations where the contrast just doesn't fit for the scene. It doesn't fit for the reality, but like, it's still always a fabrication to some extent, right? So like, and maybe all three of you have a different answer to this question, but like, to what extent do you feel that the audience is forgiving? You know what I mean? Like, are you always lighting a scene or lighting a shot with the foremost thought being like, well, what makes logistical reality sense? Or like, how far do you push it in thinking like, okay, I'm shooting the same scene and in the last shot, the key light was over here, but that really doesn't work for the next shot. So like, how far do you fudge it? Like how far, you know, like?
It's like everything, it has to be believable. And of course, once the audience believe you, and I don't think that the audience don't know what the lighting is. They just can't talk about it. They know exactly, you know, they feel the lighting, how the lighting is, light is impacting them. They maybe don't have the vocabulary to really express it or think that it was something else. It's when they talk about atmosphere, a lot of the atmosphere is lighting. You know, we all, for example, in our normal lives, when you come home from a busy day, you turn certain lights on because you want to feel a certain way. You pour a glass of wine and then you just, like, this is your favorite one, little practical, you turn other lights off. So we all do this all the time in our lives. It's right. it's not something that only we do on film. And we remember certain lighting situations attached and emotions attached to those lighting situations. So I think it's like world building, like anything we do in films, as long as it's believable, audience will go with you. So you have to convince them that this is what is, it's part of this space, this is part of this time of the day. So I always want to have some sort of logic to guide me rather than force some concept into the lighting and into the image. You know, it's like a sci-fi film. You're watching things that are not, you know, that are completely made up. But if you believe it, you believe it, and sometimes you don't believe it. So it's like,
it starts with the production design too. That informs the space, you know. And as far as getting our inspiration, you know, from, you know, the details. I mean, in his case, you know, he's representing the '70s, and for right off, you just want to be as authentic as you possibly can be, you know, with the aging of the walls, the practicals that were used in that particular at that time. One of the biggest compliments you light for the space, and then the characters are placed into that space, and something really organic about that. Yeah.
Right. But what I just wanted to say is, like, you have to build some sort of logic and then be consistent with it, and then they'll go with you. But you can't, like, every shot come up with a new logic for every shot just because it's convenient or because something needs to look good. But you can build any kind of logic you want, but then once that is what you're doing, then you have to do it.
I guess the corollary of what I was trying to say is, you know, I mean, now some other schools of thought is, hey, you got a good principal actor here, you got to make sure that he or she's got great light. And, you know, I'm a more of a kind of, I'd like for the space, and I'll put my actors in there. Of course, I'm sensitive to how they're going to appear. But I think that as far as believability, and it starts, you know, with the production design and where the light sources, the quality of that light. And I believe it, you know, it starts with the design that inspires me and that informs the lighting. Questions? Right here.
I just want to add something to it, you know. Sometimes on sets I've had people say, well, the continuity is not right because this object was there and that object is now there. And then the comment they made is, if people are watching where that object is in relationship to that, where it's the other shot, we've lost them. They're not following the story. So I think that when you have a compelling story and people are absorbed by it, a lot of things get forgiven, right? Now, moving your key dramatically from one shot to the other, that's a little bit more than the misplacement of a little object in continuity.
We've got time for one more question. Anyone? Right over here.
Do any of you have a favorite auteur?
A director or a cinematographer? What do you mean? Wow, I think it goes back to, you know, what really inspired me, it would be The Conformist. Vittorio Storaro's early films with Bertolucci, and I had the privilege of spending time with him about 3 years ago before COVID when he came to New York, and we had a few dinners together, and I couldn't believe, we've had very in-depth conversations about color and light, and interestingly enough, he really enjoyed the naive paintings from Croatia and Serbia, which is from our background. You know, both Vanya and I are from that neck of the woods. And to me it was I'd like to answer your question is there was an operatic quality of a camera movement and lighting that was very dramatic, and I have a different feeling. Like Chris Menges is another person whose work I really enjoy. Connie Hall to me is. Before he passed away, I had the opportunity to spend time with him at the museum here in Queens, and where he had a retrospective of his films. But what was really stood out for me about Connie was that there wasn't a Connie style for every film. You could say, oh, that's a Connie Hall film. He basically addressed his lighting to serve the story, and it was such a diversity of look, as there was a diversity in the subject matter and themes of the stories that he was representing. You know, so. Those are the three. And then there's also Haskell Wexler is another, who came from a documentary background. And I really feel that, one genre informs the other genre. I've done my fair share of documentaries as well. And, to think about the innovators in lighting, if they were all to be fired by the studios. Gordy Willis, when the studios were getting calls saying, you've heard this story, it's saying, look, I can't see their eyes. Well, that's the point. He's the Prince of Darkness, They wanted to get rid of him. When Vilmos Zsigmond was doing McCabe and Mrs. Miller, it looked like someone blew their nose. It was, it was a bleach process. Look, right. But then with Haskell, he did Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf? They said, what are you got a documentary guy shooting, Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, who just came off a major studio picture of Anthony and Cleopatra. All three were cited for awards, Academy Awards. So they were the innovators. They took chances. They strove to work out of the box. Guess I'm wrapping it up.
Yeah, we got one question someone. Okay, go ahead. Anonymous question here. What advice would you give someone who has a minimal lighting set, but really wants to create an emotionally resonant scene with lighting? And whoever wants to take that one.
Well, as I've gotten younger, I've decided, I've decided less is best. I really feel that, and one of the exercises that I do with my students is to say, look, you got three lights here, four at the top to express yourself. And we take our the class that I teach, we take our inspiration from the great master paintings, for example. And in fact, the Gospel of Saint the Calling of Saint Matthew, which is a famous Caravaggio piece. And if I were to show you, and I'll be happy to show you, what those students did with three lights to emulate that particular painting. So I think that's what I found, that's in our younger age, to be using far more instruments than necessary initially. But I find that there's a discipline, of just understanding, again, where is the direction of the light, where it should come from.
I would say put as much as you can in pre-production, because if you shoot at the right time of the day and you pick the right sources and the scene is blocked for light or actors react to the light, then you really don't have to do much. And this is like when you were talking about the cinematographers that influenced you. I was fortunate when I was a student, I was an intern for Sven Nykvist, who
I was going to bring him up. Yeah,
is one of the greatest cinematographers. He shot most of Bergman's films. He shot with Tarkovsky, like a giant. He was very old, and I didn't really have many responsibilities. I was basically bringing him breakfast and making sure he doesn't lose stuff on the set. But I got like 3 months. I was just talking to him, and I asked him how, because I heard somewhere that Persona, one of the most beautiful films, I think, was shot in something like 3 weeks. Bergman liked to go home after 8 hours, and you know, there was like 16 people in the crew. So it was like, how is this even possible? And then he told me, because we started talk like every year, the whole group that worked with Bergman knew that they were going to make a movie with Bergman in September. So they started talking about the film in April. They would go to every location. They knew exactly what's the right time of the day to do it. And then when you look at the making of from the film, there's not many lights there. There's, you see maybe some light bouncing in a corner, but they were at the right place at the right time. And, you know, it was just when it came to execution, they knew exactly what they were doing, which is sometimes not what we do. What we do here, we just come because there's a, we come in too late into the process. There's never enough time to make all these decisions, and then we take 2 city blocks with all the you know, all the trucks that we bring with us, because we have to be ready for anything.
I think what you're but
that would be my advice, just do as much prep as possible.
Maurizio? I would say take those 3 lights, find yourself a model, go to different corners of a room and play. And when you play and you play and you play and you play, you'll discover. And the only way to create is by discovering. We still do it a little bit like that, you know. We don't have anything written on our books by the time we go into the set, except like where Vanya says that, well, the dragons are designed before you even start putting up a light, and you have to match them. That's a very specific situation. But otherwise, you know, it's a question of taste, and it's a question of learning by mistake and also by success.
Thank you all. Thank you, Vanya. Thank you, Maurizio. And thank you.